first, by way of introduction, a light word, and then one more serious. I think God has a sense of humor. I don't normally preach in a robe in the church I come from, and so I'm wearing a robe and the air conditioning goes out. What I would have done in the church I preached at for 21 years is simply take my coat off, but I think there's a purpose for this robe, so I won't do that. Now, on a more serious note, as an outsider who comes in and who hopes soon to be an insider, a person tends to notice things. And I hope you understand the theological significance of what you just did. Week after week after week, it's always the same. Your minister or someone in the congregation opens the Word of God and reads from sacred scriptures and then pronounces, "This is the Word of the Lord." And your response is to rise and in unison sing the Gloria Patri, to praise Father, Son, and Holy Spirit for the word that you have just heard. Well, the fact that you do that, and you do that week after week after week, reminds you, and it testifies to anyone who visits, that the Word of God is the center of your life. That you have come into this place primarily to hear the Word of God. The living Word of God, who is Jesus Christ, who has come into this world to save us from our sins and also to proclaim the Father to us, and now is the resurrected one who by His Spirit continues to speak His Word. And also the written Word of God, the inspired witness to the acts and the deeds of God Himself. Week after week, that is what is central. And I need to tell you, I am honored and humbled to be invited to be a minister of the Word in your midst, to take this sacred responsibility in a church that has fulfilled this responsibility for over 200 years. Pray for me as I will pray for you. Let's pray together. Oh, Father, we consider it not just a sacred privilege to have your word, but it is by your word and every word from your mouth that we live. And so when we come into this place, we do not want to hear the mere words of a man or a woman. We want to hear from you. And so I pray that you would speak through me to your people. I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our heart would be acceptable to you, our rock and our Redeemer. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, I would like to begin not with any other story, but with the story that lies before us in Scripture. And so I'd like to ask you to try to picture in your minds what is happening in the passage which I just read. Jesus has just made his men get into a boat without him. And it's probably fairly late, maybe 7 or 8 o'clock in the evening. And the disciples start rowing, headed for a town called Bethsaida, a little village on the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And the Sea of Galilee, which is really a large lake, was about 4 miles wide at this point. And these seasoned fishermen who had spent their entire lives on this very lake could row those 4 miles perhaps in 2 hours, if all was going well. But all was not going well, was it? I mean, a storm had arisen. And apparently it's a rather violent one because the disciples are struggling. They're pulling on the oars. They're rowing against the wind. And by the fourth watch of the night, that's between 3 and 6 in the morning, these men have been rowing perhaps for 8 or 9 hours against this fierce wind, and they're still only in the middle of the lake. And it just so happens that this long night on the sea comes at the end of a rather hard week or two in the life of these disciples. And the rest of Mark chapter 6 tells the story. And since I've had the advantage of reading the story of this week, I'm going to fill you in. It all began when Jesus sent the disciples out 2 by 2 to preach and teach and heal in the villages of Galilee. And he sent them out, the text says, with no money, with no knapsack full of provisions. In fact, he forbade them to take any provisions. Instead, he told them to depend on the charity of the people in the villages to where they were going. But then Jesus warned them that they might encounter opposition because the message they were about to preach was a hard one. They were to go from town to town, calling people to repent for their sins, to prepare the way for the coming of the kingdom of God. And while they were on this challenging mission, news began to spread throughout the land of Israel that John the Baptist had just been beheaded by King Herod. Now you have to understand how this news would have affected these particular men. Some of the disciples had been followers of John before they began to follow Jesus, which means they knew John personally, and they knew what a powerful and fearless prophet of God he was. And here they were, preaching a message similar to the one that John was preaching, a message of repentance that cost him his life. So away from Jesus, on their own, without money, without protection, the disciples are preaching a message that could cost them their lives. Now, I would call that just a little bit stressful. And when these men finally finish their preaching mission, and they return to Jesus, the text reveals that they're worn out. I mean, they're physically and emotionally exhausted. But Mark tells us in verse 31 that there were so many people coming and going around Jesus, wanting to touch him, wanting to listen to him, that the disciples didn't even have time to eat when they got back, let alone rest. So Jesus says to them, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." I mean, Jesus knew how tired they were. And he knew that what they needed was time alone with him. And so they got in a boat and they rowed to a remote destination. But there was a problem. The crowd saw Jesus and the disciples go. And so they hurried around the lake. And when Jesus and the disciples arrived on land, there they were waiting for them. And I can almost hear the disciples say, "Oh, Jesus, would you please send the people away? I mean, we need rest. You said we needed rest." But Jesus, when he saw the crowd, it says in Mark chapter 6, verse 34, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And so Jesus set aside his plans for a day of rest with the disciples, and he spent the whole day shepherding these needy people, teaching them the life-giving truths of God, giving them food for their souls, if you will. And late in the day, the disciples finally come to Jesus and they say, "Please, send the people away. We're in a remote place. We're out in the middle of nowhere, in effect. And the people are obviously tired. They're hungry. There's no place for them to get any food." And I'm guessing what the disciples were also thinking is, "Jesus, we're tired and hungry. And what about that rest we were supposed to have?" But if you know Mark 6, you know what happens next. It's Jesus' most famous miracle. He feeds the whole crowd, more than 5,000 of them, with a little boy's meal, 5 cakes of barley flour and 2 little fish. And then, after that, Jesus puts his disciples in a boat alone to row to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. It's after that that the storm begins to rise and the winds begin to blow. It's after that challenging and exhausting couple of weeks of ministry, and after that very long day, that these men have to go out into that lake and row for hours and hours against the wind. So here's my question. Have you ever been there? In a place like that? I used to run cross country in high school. Now, if you saw me run now, you would find that hard to believe, but it is true. But I can still remember the feeling, I can almost taste it, of being exhausted to the point of sickness. We would run 12 quarter miles under 70 seconds with a quarter mile jog in between, and we thought our workout was over. But then the coach would say, okay, let's hit the hills. And I thought I was gonna die. I mean, racing up those foothills in Scottsdale, Arizona, in 100 degree heat with nothing left inside. I mean, it was like rowing against the wind for hours. But that's mere physical exhaustion. You see, life since high school has brought much deeper days of weariness. Like the year 1984, when Cindy and I thought our world was falling apart. I was on staff at a church that was spinning out of control as one pastor after another left, and I was given the responsibility for their ministry. Children's ministry, youth ministry, adult education, even business administration. Imagine that. And the stress was so severe that I was having nightmares at the ripe old age of 26. And then things got worse. There was an extended family crisis that I won't go into that literally turned our emotional world upside down. That was 1984, my first official year in pastoral ministry. And then there was 1990. Another crisis in our extended family forced us to move back from Cambridge, England. And I was trying to finish my doctoral dissertation while working the graveyard shift at a gas station. We lived in a 600 square foot apartment with 2 young children, and we were so financially challenged, the girls received subsidized lunches at school. And I could go on. I could talk about the year 2008. When the church I pastored had to let 4 staff members go, and I couldn't sleep night after night. I could talk about the dark nights of the soul I've spent over difficult pastoral care concerns or church discipline issues or crises in the lives of families I have loved. But the point is this. There have been days in my life, sometimes day after day after day, when all I could do was put one foot in front of the other and just keep going. And I know many of you have been there as well. Maybe some of you are there right now, rowing against the wind. You're rowing against the wind with a son or daughter because they're headed in a direction that is breaking your heart. They're sinking and they don't even know it. And you're just kind of going through the motions. You're going to work, you're coming to church, you're doing your chores around home, but inside, you're dying. Perhaps you're rowing against the wind in your marriage. I mean, no one knows how hard it is for you, what you're going through, what you have to face. You're just rowing and rowing and rowing against the wind, and it feels like you're all alone. Or maybe you're rowing against the wind at work. You're pulling against mounting pressures. You're straining against draining relationships. You're fighting a sinking depression. And it doesn't seem like you're getting anywhere. Maybe it's a friend that has let you down, or temptations that are drawing you, or trials that just won't go away. Or perhaps it's the challenges we face as a church that are weighing on your heart and making you weary. I mean, I don't have enough time to mention all the ways in which we struggle in this life. Struggle against misunderstanding, against betrayal, against fear and worry, even against spiritual forces of darkness in heavenly places, as Paul tells us in Ephesians 6. But when the winds rage and the sea billows roll, we must wonder what the disciples were wondering in that dark night so long ago. Where are you, Jesus? Don't you see what I'm struggling with? Don't you care how hard it is down here? I mean, why did you send us out in this mess anyway? You know there was a storm ahead. You always know. I mean, didn't you realize how tired we already were? Just about then, Jesus, who had been watching and praying up on the mountainside, comes walking on the water. And at first, the disciples think they're seeing a ghost. They imagine this is the end, and they cry out in fear. So Jesus says, "Do not be afraid. It is I. Take courage." And as soon as Jesus gets in the boat, the winds stop and the waves die down, and they are amazed. And make no mistake, if you or I were in the boat, we would be amazed too. But there's something I want you to notice. I want you to notice what Mark says at the very end of the passage of Scripture we read in verse 52. The disciples were completely amazed, for they had not understood about the loaves. You see, they missed it. The disciples missed it. They missed the whole point of the feeding of the 5,000. And there on the Sea of Galilee in the middle of the night, it's deja vu all over again. And just so we don't make the same mistake, I want to take us back to that miracle on the edge of the sea. I want to take us back to the moment when the disciples first came up to Jesus and said, "Please, send these people away. They need to go home and find something to eat." If you remember the story, do you remember what Jesus said to them? He looks his disciples in the eye and he says, "You give them something to eat." What do you mean, Jesus? I mean, how in the world are we supposed to do that? It would take 8 months' wages to buy just a little food for all these people, Philip says. And even if we had 8 months' wages, which we don't, there aren't any places around here where we can buy some food. We're in a remote place. What do you expect of us? Now, they didn't actually, if you read the text, they didn't actually ask Jesus such a disrespectful question. But if I had been there, that's the question I would have been thinking. I mean, what did Jesus expect them to do? Well, here's what I think. I think Jesus expected them to learn a lesson. I call it the lesson of the gap. The purpose of Jesus' command, "You give them something to eat," was not to send them scurrying to look for food in the crowd, or to pull out their calculators and tally up how much money it would take to provide food for all these people. No, the purpose of Jesus' command was to bring the disciples face to face with the impossibility of their situation. He did it to put them in a gap. What looked like an unbridgeable gap between what needed to be done and what they could do. See, a gap between what Jesus was right then commanding them to do and the resources that they had available to do it. And if you think about it, that is precisely what Jesus had been doing with the disciples during the whole 2 weeks leading up to this climactic day and night. He had sent them out into a dangerous world to preach and teach on their own without him. And he had sent them out not knowing what they would eat or where they would sleep or how they would keep themselves safe. And he sent them out into a world in which a beloved hero had just been beheaded. And then he sent them to feed 5,000 people with a little boy's lunch. And finally, he sends them out to row against the wind all night long. You see, time and time and time again in Mark chapter 6, Jesus sends his disciples into a gap, into a place where they become acutely aware of the fact that they don't have enough money or strength or skill or power to do what needs to be done. Is this beginning to sound just a little bit familiar? Why? Why would Jesus do this to his beloved disciples? And why does he still do it today to the likes of you and me? And why do we as a church face the challenges we face with all of the imperfections, confusions, frustrations, and limitations, even sins that are ours? I mean, you do realize, don't you, that Jesus could have calmed that storm much earlier? I mean, he was up there on that mountain praying to his Father in heaven, and I would imagine praying for his disciples, and he saw what was happening to them down below. He could have made it go away. I mean, the end of the story makes that very clear. Or at least Jesus could have told his disciples in advance when he put them in the boat what was going to happen to them, what he planned to do, so that at least as they were struggling, they'd have a sense of how it was going to turn out. But he didn't do that. And why didn't he? Because there are lessons to be learned in the gap that people like you and me and the disciples can usually learn in no other way. For example, it is in the gap that we really learn to trust in God. There are, I think, two sides to trust. And trust, by the way, is just another word for faith, only it's a more personal and soulful word for faith. And the first side of trust is learning that we really need to trust. Which is actually harder than it sounds, because there's just something about human beings that does not trust very easily. I mean, usually we have to be put in a position where we must trust before we are willing to trust. I mean, for example, I can say that I trust God with my finances. It's rather easy to say that. And I can even say that my tithe or my decision to give more than 10% of my income to God is a sign of that trust. And according to the Word of God, that is true. But do you know when we really trust God with our finances? When there isn't enough. When we lose our job. Or the bottom drops out of the market, or we have to send a child to college and the money is running out. See, when a gap opens up between what we need and what we have, and we can't figure out a way to bridge that gap, that's when we really need to trust in God. So the first side of trust is learning that I really need to depend on God. And the second is discovering that I can. I can depend on God to meet every need in my life. Over a decade ago, I led, the church I led was going through a building project, a rather large building project. And it did me a world of good to go through that building project during a season in which we had to send our daughters to college, because the two simply didn't fit together. Giving above and beyond our tithe to the church building and paying college tuition bills. At least it didn't fit together in our budget. We didn't have the resources to do both. There was a gap. But it was in that gap that we learned to trust in God. And it was in that gap that I experienced in a special way the empowering presence of God. I will always remember that dark night of the soul during our building project, when I was fighting with God, bespäten die Nacht, deep into the night. I was crying out to Him, I think for hours. How am I supposed to do this? How am I supposed to fulfill my obligation to this church, to do what I as a pastor am calling other people to do, and still send my daughters to college? And I have to tell you, I was frustrated. In fact, I was not just a little bit angry with God. And around 2 a.m, I heard in my mind a voice that I take to be the voice of God. And twice He asked, "Will you trust Me? Will you trust Me?" That was the end of the discussion. I got up off my knees, I went to bed, and I slept. And over the next few years, God proved Himself supremely worthy of that trust. He provided for our family in ways that we never expected. And our faith has grown. You see, it was in the gap between God's call upon their lives and the disciples' inability to fulfill that call that they experienced the power of God. They actually saw demons cast out and people healed at their touch as they preached through those villages of Galilee. They saw their physical and financial needs met by God through the generosity of His people, whom they hadn't even met yet. They saw 5,000 people fed on a little boy's lunch, and there were 12 baskets of food left over, one for each disciple. Do you think that might have been a little object lesson in the power and the provision of God? They saw Jesus come walking on water. One of them, Peter, even walked on water himself. Until, of course, the winds and the waves convinced him that maybe this particular gap was too big even for God. And he began to sink. See, the truth is, God is always at work in our lives, meeting our needs, conforming us into the likeness of His Son, building His church so the gates, the very gates of hell, will not be able to stand against it. And if, for a moment, God were to stop working, everything in this universe would literally fly apart at the seams. Because as Paul tells us in Colossians, the Word of God, God holds all things together by His all-powerful Word. I mean, that's the truth. But it is also true that we often do not realize that God is working until we are living in a gap. So God puts us in the gap so we can learn to trust. And God puts us in a gap so that He can show us Himself and we can experience His empowering presence. And finally, God puts us in the gap so He can do His deeper work in us. God's deepest work requires that we spend time at the oars, rowing, rowing, rowing against the wind. Because there is a kind of lesson learned when a problem is solved in a matter of days or hours. And there is a kind of lesson learned and a character developed when the challenge grinds on month after month and year after year. I once read a story about someone watching a logger in Italy. And as the cut logs drifted down the mountain stream, this logger would occasionally reach out with a long pole that had a metal hook on the end. And he'd grab one of those logs and he'd pull it away from the rest, and then he'd guide it into an alcove on the side of the river. And after watching this logger do that occasionally for an hour or so, the observer just had to know why, and so he asked him what he was doing. This is what the logger said. "All these logs probably look the same to you, don't they? But they're not. The logs I let pass, the ones that float down the river to the mill below, those are the more normal ones. Their grain is average. In fact, it's rather coarse. And we use those logs for common purposes, like cutting framing boards or making shelves. But the other logs, the few that I pull aside, they come from high up on this mountain, where the winds blow constantly, and the weather can be quite fierce. And the constant pressure of that wind has caused these trees to grow more slowly and to grow dense, and therefore to have a finer grain. And so we pull these logs aside and we use them for a special purpose, like making fine furniture or musical instruments or carving a piece of art. You see, I have become convinced over the years that the deepest work of God and the most beautiful qualities of soul are born out of adversity, from rowing against the wind for a long, long time. I mean, test me on this. Think of the people you most admire, the people who most reflect the life of Christ. Have they not suffered? Have they not rowed against the wind? Think of the marriages that are most worthy of imitation. Have they not grown deep grains as their two souls become one, rowing against the wind? I mean, think of the people you would go to for advice. Or even more importantly, the people you might trust with your life. Have they not suffered? See, it's in the gap, with the wind against us, that God does his deepest and best work as we learn to trust in him, and as a result, we experience his presence and his power. I mean, of all things, does not the cross of Jesus Christ teach us that? Is not that the lesson we learn from the oft-repeated journey of God's chosen leaders into a difficult wilderness before they're used of him? Isn't this the truth that Park Street needs to hang on to as we weather our own storms? One more thought. Did you notice that when Jesus got in the boat, the struggle ceased? And did you notice that Jesus was going to pass his disciples by until they cried out to him? I believe there may be many here today who are weary of rowing against the wind, of living in one God-ordained gap after another. I happen to be one of them. But you know, after a week at Park Street, I don't think I'm going to be getting out of the gap for some time. Now, I cannot promise you that God will cause your personal gap or this church's gap to close in the next few days or months or even years. But I can say this: it makes a difference when Jesus gets into the boat. And I, for one, need Jesus in my boat. I need him here by my side every moment of every day, making the difference that only Jesus can make. I need him today. I need him tomorrow. How about you? How about all of us as a church? Let's take a moment right now to invite Jesus into our boat again. Let's pray. Oh, Father in heaven, we take comfort in your promises to us that you, your Son, and your Spirit will never leave us or forsake us. That you will cause all things to work together for good in our lives. That you will fulfill your good purposes for us. But Father, some of us, and in some sense all of us together, are feeling the inability to be what you are calling us to be, to do what you are calling us to do. We need your empowering presence. We need you in our boat as we faithfully attempt to row, even if it's rowing against the wind. Bring us to the appointed place that you have for us and sustain us in our journey with you. But whatever else you do, do not tell us to go somewhere if you are not going to go with us. In the strong name of Jesus, we pray. By the power of his indwelling spirit. Amen.